In the last section, we talked about climate changes over millions and tens of millions of years. In this lecture, we're going to zoom in on a small part of this record of the last 65 million years, looking in particular at this little spike right here. This spike is a good example of much faster climate changes. It's called the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum, or the PETM. And if we zoom in on it, what we see here are records, again, from deep sea foraminifera. So this is recording conditions in the deep ocean. And we see that in many different deep sea sediment cores, we have a rapid decrease in the delta 18 recorded by these foraminifera. At this time, when there's very little permanent ice at the poles, the delta 18 recorded by these foraminifera mostly tells us about the temperature of the deep ocean. And so this delta 18 record is converted to deep sea temperature over on the right-hand side. So we see about a 5-degree increase in the temperature of the deep sea at this time. Shown above is the carbon isotopic composition of those same shells. This is the standard normalized carbon 13 to carbon 12 ratio. So we see that relative to the standard, the shells get much more negative at the same time that this warming occurs. This is consistent with the addition of carbon from an isotopically distinct reservoir into the ocean and atmosphere system. That last slide showed us evidence for a temperature increase in the deep sea, which probably tells us about conditions near the poles. We can go to sediment cores from near the tropics and look at foraminifera that live in the surface ocean to get a sense of the tropical sea surface temperature response to this event. Shown here are various paleotemperature estimates from surface-dwelling species with time going from older to younger as we move up the plot, and the temperature anomaly relative to the baseline shown on the horizontal axis. So depending on the paleothermometer that you use, you get anywhere from a 2.5 to about a 5.5-degree warming associated with this event. We understand that the tropics generally change temperature less than the poles, and so when you average over the whole Earth, you get estimates of something like a 5 to 9 degree C rise associated with this event, taking place over about 1 to 10,000 years, which is about the time scale that's estimated by most researchers for the carbon input into the system. We understand that carbon input into the ocean atmosphere system leads to decreases in ocean pH, that is, an ocean acidification. We'll talk a little bit more about that in the carbon cycle lecture, but what I'd like to point out here is evidence for this acidification associated with the PETM. In each of these blue plots, the authors are plotting the calcium carbonate content of these deep sea cores that are from different water depths, going from shallower to deeper as you go from left to right across the diagram. In each of these sediment cores, there's an abrupt decrease in the calcium carbonate content associated with the PETM. You can see that in the blue plots. You can also see it visually from these photographs of the cores as the sediments move from white, chalky, calcium carbonate-rich sediments to dark brown clays as you move into the PETM. These dark brown clays are just the residual, the non-carbonate fraction of the cores, and they're all that's left after you've dissolved out the calcium carbonate. So this acidification is consistent with a large input of carbon into the ocean atmosphere system. Records from the PETM also give us interesting insights into the response of the Earth system to an abrupt input of carbon into the ocean and atmosphere. We see that it takes about 200,000 years here for temperatures to return to something like their pre-event values, and for the isotopic composition of carbon in the ocean atmosphere system to return to its baseline. We'll talk about the mechanisms of this response in the Earth system to abrupt carbon inputs in the carbon cycle lecture. So the PETM appears to be a time when there was an abrupt input of carbon into the ocean atmosphere system. There was warming and ocean acidification, and it took something like 200,000 years for the Earth system to recover. So for all these reasons, it's looked to as an analog for anthropogenic carbon inputs. But where did the carbon come from in the example of the PETM? Well, there are many hypotheses. These include methane hydrates from deep sea sediments volcanic intrusion into organic-rich sediments in the deep sea, which would turn the organic matter into thermogenic methane and release it into the ocean and atmosphere. Melting permafrost near the poles. Massive wildfires that led to terrestrial biomass burning. Or the drying of shallow seas on the continents and the subsequent oxidation of carbon in these organic-rich sediments. It should also be said that these carbon sources are not mutually exclusive. It could be that release of one led to positive feedbacks that led to release from another reservoir. Well, how much carbon was released? Well, to estimate this, one approach that's taken is to look at that carbon isotope excursion that was shown in the previous slides. And if you average that over the world, you get something like a 4 to 5 per mil excursion in the isotopic composition of carbon in the ocean atmosphere system. Each of these hypothesized sources has a characteristic C13 to C12 ratio. If you have a lower C13 to C12 ratio, for instance in methane hydrate, you need less of an input to get the observed carbon isotope excursion. So in the case of methane hydrates, it's estimated that you'd need something like 5,000 petagrams of carbon released to get the observed carbon isotope excursion. And using a carbon cycle model, researchers have estimated that that would lead to something like a 1,000 to 1,500 ppm increase in atmospheric PCO2. If you have a less C13 depleted source, like wildfire or the drying of shallow seas, you would need much more carbon to get the observed carbon isotope excursion, something like 15,000 petagrams of carbon, and of course that would lead to a much larger increase in atmospheric PCO2. For reference, estimates of the modern stock of fossil fuels available for our consumption is something like 5,000 petagrams carbon. So these are very, very large inputs of carbon into the ocean atmosphere system over geologically relatively short timescales. Research is currently focused on identifying these sources of carbon and trying to better understand the temperature response that is observed during this event to see if it squares with our notion of the climate sensitivity to CO2 increases.